Introduction to graphic design. In this module, in this first module, we are going to learn the work of line, the work of color, the work of shape, texture, form, typography, contrast, all these things. These are things that you see in design that make designs look good. And I won't also be talking about these things. I'll be showing you practical examples of how I have used it in my own designs and how other designers have also used it in their own designs as well. So that it won't just be theoretical, it's going to be practical. So that anytime you want to work on your own designs as well, you know how to use line, how to use color, how to use shape, texture, and all these things. And please, please, and please, today is, like you see, the topic is introduction to graphic design. So what we are just doing today is just introduction. In the course of the week, we are going to go deep into lines, into colors, into shape, especially typography. Typography is a very serious place in design. If your font is very, very bad, in fact, typography is 90% of design, because it's possible for you to do design without picture, without color, without text, without form, but there's no way you want to do a design without typography. Typography is the most important aspect of design. Any design you see out there, if everything is right and the typography is wrong, everything else is wrong. Please, I hope you got that. Every design you see out there, if every other thing is right and the typography is wrong, every other thing is automatically wrong. Typography is like the most important aspect of design. You can't push it away. If your typography is right, it can still complement other things on your design. Okay, one of the persons I learned from while growing or while I was learning design is Gareth David. In art and in design, the first point of design or art is a dot. That means that for every design you see, there is always a dot. Now, you might not see the dot. Let me go back to this page. You might not see the dot, but if you zoom in, you can see pixels. I hope you guys can see boxes. You can see small boxes there. Can you see it? You can see small boxes. This is from somebody's image. So this shows you that this is the beginning of design. This is the start point. Each box you see like this is what comes together to form what you are seeing. What forms this yellow rectangle here, this thing here, is boxes. If you zoom in very well, you get to some point whereby you can see some boxes broken and they're not getting straight back. There's a reason for them getting. The beginning of every design is a dot or a line. Do you understand? The start point of every design. So there's no design you see out there that doesn't have a line or doesn't have a dot. It's not possible. It must have either of the two or even both. Now, what is the work of line in a design? Lines can be used for dividing compositions. They can be used for creating separations. I can remember a design I did, and I'll show you how line is creating a division. Now, in fact, don't even let me go far. Look at this here. Look at this. You can see a line showing that there's a division between this part and this part. You can see line working here. You can see line, right? You see line here. This is line working. Okay, no problem. This is the work of line. This is how to use line. Lines can do division. In fact, let me go back. See division. See line working. See the work of line. So lines can be used for dividing composition, for separation, for telling you that this is plan A, this is plan B. This is even from this. Don't mix them together. Let's look at the work of line in this design. Let me make it bigger. Look at line here. Look at the yellow line here. What does this yellow line? What is it doing? It's separating this composition. This part is separating it from this other part. You can see the work of, you can see the line working as an element of division here. You can see it's working as an element of separation here. It's separating this part from this part. It's telling you that this just read this information first before going elsewhere. Just everything here is together. they are together. Don't mix them up. Do you get? See line working here too. What's he doing here? He's separating the end line from the body text. This is what we call body text. Body text is like the smallest part of text in a design. For instance, I just want to show you what body text is so that you understand. Now look at this design. This is the header or the edging. Then this is the body text. This part that I'm highlighting is the body text. So in case you hear someone say body text, this is what they are referring to. Body text is the smallest part that people read in design. And the font you use for this body text is very, very important. In fact, more important than the font you use here. You might be surprised. Don't be surprised. The font you use here is more important than the font you use here. Because the font you use there must be readable. If you use a bad font here, nobody will be able to read your book or your proposal or whatever it is. Do you understand? So don't let us, we are still coming back to this. We are still going to discuss this. But let's go back to the design. Now, line is doing the work of separation, separating the heading from the body text here. The same thing happens here. The same thing happens here. You can see line doing work in here. You can see line working here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Work of line here too. You can see line separating the text from the image. From a, don't let me call this it's image, but just let me call it vectors or illustration. Let me call it illustration. You can see line doing the work of separation, separating this part from this part. So the reason why we are talking about this and going detailed into line like this is because in your own design, you have to think about how can I use line to separate information? How can I use line to create division or to show composition? Line is showing composition in this place. You see, it's showing that this part is separate. Like this is just section. This is a separate section. Here we have another separate section. The information that are here are together. The information that are here are together. Don't mix everything up. The information here is different from the information here. The information here is different from the information here. Do you understand? So that this is line creating division. So in your own design, you have to think, how can I use line to create division? How can I use line to create composition and separation? Do you understand? So let me quickly go back here and we continue. Now, one thing also is that in design, apart from all these things working, they also add to the beauty of design. In fact, line also can be used for adding emphasis to a design. There are some designs that when you see them, you see that you see a rectangle under the shape. Lines can be used for emphasis. It can be used for drawing emphasis to a particular thing in design. For instance, coming to this, actually, you might actually use this and just move on. Just imagine there's no line here. It should look normal, but when there's a line there, it's telling you to pay more attention to that area. It's holding it up. Of course, as you can see here, lines can be thin, it can be mid solid, it can be big solid, it can be zigzag, it can be dots, it can be broken, it can be straight. Aha. These are those types of lines. Okay, moving on to the... Okay, this is just showing us how line works as well. I didn't even see this. Here, line is stressing a word. You can see line stressing ideas, stressing ideas. You can see, though not line alone, but line and color. Line here is working as border and even separation. You can see line separating this part of the design from this part. You can see line here showing us structure. You can see telling us this is for chapter 1, separating it, chapter 2, chapter 3, and chapter 4. You can also see line here giving us structure as well. This is a different element, this is a different element. Even line here is showing division and even composition. You can see lines working here. You can see it's working here, here, and even at the top here. And you know, like I said, lines also add to the beauty of design. Look at samples of it. This thing, just imagine if this thing is not there, this line here and the one here. Just imagine if they are not there. This thing will still look good, to be honest, it will still look good. but this will be better. So, like I said, lines also add to beauty. Okay, color is one of the topics that gives almost every designer issues. And when I say almost every designer, I'm talking about myself. Sometimes I don't get hands on colors as much as I want to do. It's not because I don't know design again. That's not the reason. But basically because colors can give meanings to design. If you are designing something, if you change the color can change the meaning of that design. Just imagine if you wrote death, like D-E-A-T-H, and you wrote death, and use black, like the text is written in black, death. Anybody that sees that will be thinking of death, like Iku. But just imagine if you wrote death and make it green. How does green relate to death? You have lost your audience if you should do that. So black is more related to death. So the message in the word death is incomplete if you use green as a color. But it will be fully complete and understood if you use black. You can see how black is adding to meaning and is even giving meaning to words. If you have a blank canvas and you just painted everything black, what meaning do you think is going to give to people that are going to see that canvas? They will probably be thinking about sadness. Well, in Nigeria, black denotes sadness, anguish, evil, horror. But white denotes purity. It denotes innocence. So that means that if you have design and you want to communicate the message of purity, of innocence, and you're using black, my brother, you're on the wrong road. But if you want to communicate anguish, sorrow, sadness, and you use black, you are on point. You are moving. Although, please do not take it. It's not written. It's not cast on stones. It doesn't mean that everywhere you see black, it's only sorrow, sadness. Like you don't know. Let's pick red for instance. Red is a color that denotes love, right? It denotes love. It can also denote danger. So you won't say that every year you see red, it is danger, danger, danger. No. Red can also denote love. It can even denote energy. When you say that somebody is energetic or something is full of energy, you can use red to denote it. You can even use red to denote warning. So this is to tell you that all these colors, they have contextual meanings. What do I mean by that? The areas where you use the colors determines the meaning you give it. So just imagine if you wrote love and you think it's red. Everybody can relate. Love, red, of course. But if you write danger and you paint it red, everybody can also do. They can also relate. So it means that the context in which you are using that color will determine the meaning you are giving to that color. But do not forget that sometimes when you create your designs and you use the wrong color, you can denote a different meaning to your audience. Just imagine if you wrote Twitter, like that Twitter bed, if you paint it black, and maybe just put it on a blank canvas and just paint it black, what meaning are you depicting or are you denoting to people? You are probably talking about the Twitter ban. But if that bed is blue, you are saying that in Yoruba land there's something you say. In case you don't understand Yoruba, I will try to interpret it, but I may not be very perfect, of course. In Yoruba land, there's something you say that it means that things are going on normally. So when you say that it means that things are going on normally. It means the birds are crying like the birds, and the mice or the rats are crying like the rats. So it means that everything is going on normally. But the moment the rat starts crying like a bird, or a bird starts crying like a rat, there's a problem. Do you understand? So I want to just read that to Twitter, or let me say the Twitter ban. If you use blue for the color of Twitter, of course it means that Twitter is going normally. Twitter is tweeting. Do you understand? But the moment you paint it black, any Nigerian that sees that, you think Twitter ban. Twitter ban. Do you understand? You can see how color changes the meaning of what Twitter is. Do you understand? So color is a very important aspect of design that you must not even throw away. In fact, in the course of this class, there is even a particular module that is just for colors alone. I will tell you how you can get colors. I don't expect you to just sit down and just think, okay, I want to use blue. So I just, no, what should you use blue? Don't just sit down and just say, hey, as it's doing it today, I feel like I should use black. Why? When you are designing, there must be a reason for the colors you are using, for the lines you are using, for the font you are using, for the space you are using. There must be reasons for everything that you know your design. So, how do you select colors? How do you know the colors you use at a particular point in time? Especially because you are a beginner. You are just learning design, you are not so good at design. How do you know the colors you use? I'm going to teach you all that in this class. One thing is that colors are around you and you don't even know. If I ask you, especially the ladies that are in this class, please, wait for the ladies in this class, when you wanted to go out today, what clothes did you wear? Why did you pick that cloth? Have you ever seen a lady wear a blue top and a red shoe and carry a green bag? Ladies will not dress like that. There's a reason. The reason is here. Is here. Color harmony. Whenever ladies dress, there must be an harmony in their dressing. Even if the harmony is not that strong, there must be something denoting some. For instance, their earring can just be color blue and their clothes will be blue and red. So it means that there is blue in the earring and there is blue in the clothes. That's, you can see how someone uses colors to create design. Just color. Nothing else, just colors. You can see someone like walking in the desert. You can see the moon. You can see the desert showing here. In fact, if you look at this very well, it looks like the shape of a lady, of a woman. But then, this, I'm just showing you how colors work. You can see colors. Look at color depicting design here. Maybe this. Just black and yellow. Sorry, it's going off and on. You can see. See colors working. Just two colors, black and white. Then this thing is called negative space. You are still coming to that. Or let me just explain that. There's something called negative space or white space. It doesn't mean that the place is negative. It means the empty spaces around in your design. If you look at this website, there's negative space. All these blank spaces, they are called negative space or white space. Negative space or white space. Let me type it in the chat box. Negative space or white space. That's what it is called. And negative space gives harmony to design. It gives coordination to design. And do you also know that we have been seeing negative space everywhere? In fact, everybody on this call has seen negative spaces. Maybe like 4 times today. If not today, you must have seen it 4 times this week. Who am I? Why should I say that? Am I living with you? Do I know where you go to? Why should I say you've seen negative space? If you know you have ever used Google before, google.com, you have seen negative space. Have you tried to let me visit the website? Let's go to google.com. Google.com. You see how negative space is working. Look at, I don't know why my Google is coming up this way. What's happening? Don't like all this old stuff. Aha, look at Google. See white spaces around. It gives you peace of mind. Even when you come to the site, you have peace of mind. You'll be happy. That's the work of negative space. Negative space gives harmony. It gives rest to design. The best way I can explain negative space for you is this. Just imagine you, if you are married, just imagine you and your wife in your room. Only you and your wife in the room. Nobody else. You'll be able to breathe. Or now compare it to maybe you guys want to do maybe a ceremony, then when you want to do ceremonies like that, extended families will come around, everybody will be in the house, they'll be shouting, talking, watching TV. Some people will be gisting about football, some will be discussing one girl that got pregnant somewhere, and that person will be discussing, you know, even children. Children will be discussing PJ Mark and watching cartoons and all. You'll be able to grid. That's the same thing that applies to design. In design, when there is spaces around in your design will grid, your text will grid, your font will grid, your colors, the wall space. Oh my god. Now, let me show you a design. Look at this design. The information is actually clustered. This information are very plenty. Very, very plenty. But because I know that space, negative space, is very important, I have to create spaces around. You can see. So that all these things can breed. The space that you are seeing is intentional for the first design. This is the first design of this one. Now, if you look at this, the information here is actually clustered. It's so clustered. To be honest, let's be honest with ourselves. This information is super. Of course, you're going to you get it. You will like it. It's a good design. You get the information. It's well explanatory. It's simple. Yeah, of course. But do you think you want to take your time to read through all these things? Especially this small text here. Do you think you want to really go through the time of reading everything? So I thought about that, and I had to do a redesign version of this same design. This same design you are looking at. I had to do a second version. This is the second version of the same. In fact, you can see that I think the clothes she's putting on is even the same. Not the same, but the same stuff. It's the same content. But because I know that this design you are looking at, yeah, we have small spaces around, but can you read all these things? Can you read it? Can you even see this? So I consider that in the next design, and I did this. Now, this is a bit bigger. You can see it there. You can see it. And this, looking at this, it doesn't look like you have a bulk of information to read. It looks minimal, unlike this one. It's just like, if you are a student here, you understand this thing. If you have a class or you have an exam, and the course material is like 20 books, there's another exam that the course material is just one book or two. Which one will you be happy to read? The one that has a lesser course material, of course. So that's the same thing that is happening here as well. Do you understand? So when you are designing, you have to always think of having space in your design. Putting space. Space is a very important aspect of your design. Let me see pieces around. It helps the design. It helps to coordinate your height. Do you understand? I don't know why I'm stressing negative space. Negative space is a very important aspect of design. Very, very important. Look at this. All the messages embedded here. I am free. See the time. Everything is clear. But still space is around. The design will be able to breathe. You know I'm out there. Do you understand? Let me move on. Look at this. You know, if you can remember, I told you that your font is the most important aspect of your design. Look at it here. There's nothing else here apart from font and colors. And probably shape. Just font and colors. You can see fonts working here. You can see font and colors alone. There's no, and of course you can see spaces around as well. But this one is showing the importance of typography in your design. You have to have a good knowledge of typography. And lastly, let me just take you to one. There's one particular design that I did for our Thanksgiving game. If I can't see it, I'll probably just stop and... Okay, let me show you this again. Look at spaces. I hope you understand, you can see the importance and the value of space in your design. Space is a very important aspect of your design. You have to like... In fact, you have to hold it. It's premium. Let's really go back to... okay, so I've already explained space. I've explained colors. We are still going deep into all these things. Now, shape. Shape gives meaning to your design as well. I can remember that when I was learning logo design, one thing about shape is that if you are doing a design for a baby brand, maybe a brand that sells trolley, they sell pampers, they sell all these things, if you go and check all those brands, you will never see them using sharp objects or sharp shapes like triangle, rectangle. You never see them use them in their designs. They use curved fonts, curved shapes. Shapes that are curved. They won't use shapes that are sharp, because sharp edges of shapes communicate aggressiveness. But when you use a shape that is round, that is curved, you are communicating friendliness. Do you understand? All these things have their meaning. Very, very, very important. They have their meaning. And whenever you are designing, you have to be thinking about it. Which shape should I use? Should I use a circle? Should I use a rectangle? And do you also know that shape can also determine the meaning that people read to your design? Shape can even do a form of division in your design. Let me show you where shape is showing division. Look at this. This upper part of the design, this upper part, it has a separate information. This bottom part has another separate information. If you look at it very well, this place is not telling you, okay, read every information you need here. Are you done reading? Are you done? If you know you like this information, this is the call to action. You can see shape showing the division. And I even did it in this lady's work as well. That design I showed you, you notice that the bottom part of it has a different color. And the upper part has a different color. You can see it here as well. This has a different color. It's showing you that this is the stepping information compared to this. So here we have three separate forms of information. We have one here. This is one. This is the second one. And this is the third one. Do we understand? So you can say that even shape can determine the way people will view your design. You can even use shape to do your call to action in your design. Okay, moving on. Of course, so I already explained this. You have different types of shape. You have the rectangle, the circle, polygon, you know, and all. And shapes are also used for logo design. But then we are not really going deep into that now. What we are just doing right now is just, what do I call it? Introduction. Now, texture. Texture is the look and feel of your design. But I always advise everybody that wants to design that, don't make your background to be too empty. If your background is too empty, the design will look bland to people. People don't like it. So even if it's empty, don't let it be totally empty. If you look at this design, you may not see it before now, but if you look at this design very well, you see a hand. You see, there's somebody's hand here, pressing laptop. You might not see it there before. I actually don't expect this. Please, if you can see, just unmute and say I can see it, or just drop a message in the comment section and say I can see it.
I see it though.
Aha.
Okay.
Very good, very good. You can see one person's hand pressing laptop here. That's because it's always good when you add texture to your design. It's very, very important. Texture in your design is very, very key. In fact, if I go to this lady's page, if I open this, you will see that they have some written text in the background. Because the design is talking about content writing, it's talking about writing. So the background should be showing something related to the meaning of the entire design. Everything has to work together in one. So that's why I have to use image of like a text that someone is writing on the paper. It's just to depict writing, content writing. Do you understand? So you can see the importance of texture. That's texture. Texture is just the background. The background you give your design. It goes a long way to give meaning to your design as well. Then moving on. Pattern and texture, the same thing. Okay, I've already discussed this. Now, form is basically when your design element is either flat or is 3D or 2D. Now, this one that you're looking at, people will call it 3D. This one is flat. This is what we call 2D. 2D is two-dimensional. 3D is three-dimensional. Three-dimensional shapes usually have weight somewhere. They have shadows. They have hues. Look at this. You see shadow here, a little bit of shadow here, blending out. You see a little bit of shadow here too, blending out. You see a little bit of shadow here too, blending out. All these things are the things that come together to make it 3D. But if it is 2D, it's just flat, like what you can see here. Just flat, plain flat. Now, when you are designing logos, because in this class, you are going to design logos as well. So I'm going to group you guys. Somebody will be designing logo, some will be social media flyers and all. You guys are going to work in group. But please, I want you guys to pay attention. whoever is going to design your logo should be flat. You know the reason? The reason is because when you want to print it, there won't be a problem. Most of the time, logos that are not flat are usually problematic, whatever they want to print. So it's only if you know you want to solve a problem for your client as a designer, you don't want them to go through the problem of saying that you give them a logo of 3D and they have to go and start thinking of how they will get it to be printed. If you're a good designer and you love your client, you do the 3D version and do the 2D version as well. But for me, I don't even do 3D version at all. I just give it to you 2D. So that you don't have to come in the next 6 months and say, Victor, that logo that you did for us, we want to print it, it's giving us issues. I don't want you to come in for that. I want to just do the work for you and you'll be happy. Even when you want to print it, you see that 3D will tell you problem. For those that don't understand you, you just think that this doesn't have any problem at all. So it's always good for you to do your design, especially your logo design, in 2D. Very, very important. Moving on, typography. When you think about typography, you're thinking about font. But please, do not confuse typography for font or type. Because I see a lot of people that will tell me, what's the name of that font? It's actually very wrong, actually. When you talk about font, you're talking about one of the popular fonts that everybody probably needs is Arial. It comes with Microsoft Word, Arial. Now, let me go to this and explain what font is and what typography is, so that you guys understand better. Now, if you look at this, this is a font. This is a font. This is a font. This is a font. Everything you are seeing, like, looking at, like, they are all fonts. Now, why are they fonts? Why didn't I call them typography or typeface? The reason why they are fonts is because when you're talking about fonts, you're talking about the name of the font and the size of the font. So this one I did now is Product Sans 18 Bold. That's the font. This one like this, I am looking at it like this now, is Product Sans 11 is not bold. That's it. That's a different font. But when you're not talking about everything, whether bold or not bold or italics or underline everything, that's what you're not talking about typeface. Typeface is when you group everything. What I'll do now is that I'll send a folder of a font to the group chat. If you open that folder on your laptop, you will see that the folder is going to have a vertical new, a vertical new italics, a vertical new medium, a vertical new semi-bold, a vertical new bold. So when you combine everything like that together in typeface, but when you're talking about a vertical new, that's the font. A vertical new medium, that's another font. A vertical new semi-bold, that's another font. A vertical new extra bold, that's another font. So when you put fonts together, you now have typography or typeface. So please do not confuse it. A lot of designers out there, they don't know the difference between font and typography or typeface. Everything is fonts to them. Please don't fall into that category of designers. If you want to ask for font, ask for font. If you want to ask for typeface, ask for typeface. So another typeface that is probably common that almost everybody knows is Helvetica and Roboto. Now, Helvetica is a typeface. Roboto is a typeface. But the moment you're talking about a vertical new, a vertical bold, a vertical semi-bold, that's font on their own. If you're talking about Roboto normal, Roboto regular, Roboto medium, Roboto semi-bold, Roboto bold, Roboto extra bold, Roboto black, all those ones, those are fonts on their own. But when you put them together, it will not give the Roboto typeface, a vertical typeface, Arial typeface, Product Sans typeface. Do you understand? Please, if you understand, just drop a message in the comment section or just unmute and yes, and say yes, I understand. At least one person, so I can go ahead. Okay, I think Orlando was the first. Okay, don't worry. I get the message. I think your network is a bit bad, actually. But then it's fine. Now, looking at fonts, all these things have names. Let me zoom in. But the truth is that we don't need to bug ourselves with this thing, with this naming, knowing the names of all these things. This is a stem of a font. This is a slab. this is a bowl. So they all have names. But one thing I want you to keep in mind is that we have different categories of fonts. You have the serif font and the sans serif font. We also have the display font and the script font or the handwritten font. Please keep this in mind. Philip, you have the serif font and the sans serif. Serif means that the font has all these, all these things that are coming out like this, all these things, that's the serif font. But a non-serif, or sorry, a sans serif, means that all these things are not there. Let me see if there is. Okay, very good. See, a sans, this is a sans serif font. You can see that sans serif is not from a serif. Look at serif. Serif has all these sharp edges. You can see. But the sans serif doesn't have any sharp edges. Everything is just rounded and straight and okay and normal. When do you use slab serif? Sorry, when do you use sans serif? You use sans serif for modern things, modern designs. When you want to do a design for things that are modern, for things that are like you are talking about fintech, you are talking about graphic design, product design, all those things, that you have to use sans serif because they are modern things. But if you want to write, you want to write or you want to type something that is related to the old age, maybe you want to talk about the 20th century war, or you want to talk about the 3G war, you have to come and use serif. These are the fonts that they were using in that during that period. Do you understand? So you have to use this kind of serif to talk about traditional things. Now this is slab serif. Slab serif is usually used for things when you want to talk about strength or power. That's why you use sans serif. That's why if you look at all the fonts of Wesley, most of them is always sans serif because they are talking about power. Who is the heavyweight champion? Who can lift you? So they usually use slab serif. Now rounded, this rounded font are only used for things that are friendly, things around children, things around family, you know, friendly stuff like that. That's what they use rounded fonts for. And this is what we call script fonts. Script fonts are the ones that look like they are handwritten and all. Actually, you really do not need this. But let me just go and touch everything. When you talk about black letter, you're talking about the Romans font. Oh, we'll be kicked out very soon in 10 minutes as well. So please. So when you're talking about black letter, you're talking about fonts that are used in the Roman period. So, and that's why I said that you don't really need it. Decoration fonts are fonts that are used for fun, maybe a party, you know, in the Western world. Abstract fonts are fonts that are used for usually branding that are not, that the things they do is not conceptual, is not contextual, it's not something that you can hold on to, like Paystack, for instance. What Paystack does is just online payments, online, you know, online things. So if the logo is around this kind of font, it's not bad. But actually, Paystack is actually a modern invention. That's why their font is always sans serif. Paystack is sans serif, Flutterwave, all these brands are saying sans serif. But when you're talking about newspaper, The Guardian, The Punch, all these things, they usually use serif. Because newspaper and magazine is something that there are things that have been happening in the old days, not now. They are not recent happening. So that's why they use serif. And serif is always used for things that are to be read, things that are going to be printed. So if you are writing, if you are designing for a book, the inner cover of a book should be serif. Because even all these things, they have a way they coordinate each other. We are going to talk about that in the class on typography. Don't worry. So these are examples of people using typography to design. Look at this. I finished the design one time. I don't know if it's still on my page. Let me check. If it's still on my page, I'll show you the design. I used only fonts to create the design. And I'm going to, I would love you guys to do the same thing. Sorry, 1 minute. I just want to go to my page and see if I have not taken down the design. I wrote letter A with just a single font. I'm not sure if it's not here. But even if you look at this, everything here is just font. Just font and colors. Font and colors. That's all you can see here. So you can still see the importance of fun. Let me go to my business page if it's there. Yeah, this is absolutely. Look at this to design. So this is part of the time when I was still learning, you know, typography in design. You know, I had to learn. So while I was learning, in the course of me learning, the font that I saw as the font of the year for 2019 when I started learning typography is Helvetica. Since that time, I've been using Helvetica till today in most of my designs. In fact, if you look at this design for the class, this is Helvetica. All the fonts you see here is Helvetica. Everything, apart from the fonts for this logo, every other thing you see is Helvetica. So since that time, I've taken Helvetica as my most passionate and loved font. And don't be surprised if you too, you eventually pick one font and you work with it. It's not bad as a designer to have a go-to font. In fact, if you go to my page, I actually discuss it because some people are saying that having a go-to font is a bad idea. And for me, it is not a bad idea. You should have some go-to font as a designer. This is it. Go-to font for your body color. Like, you should have good fonts that you always, you try them first for all your designs. So it's not a bad thing if you have fonts that you go to first. So for me, these are some of the fonts I go to first. But when it comes to edging, the font I go to first is Helvetica. Because Helvetica works almost everywhere. Everywhere. Helvetica is the kind of font that is not related to anything. Don't let us go deep too much into that, because if I start talking about that now, we will not leave here today. So let's just come back. I hope you guys, you understand what I'm saying. You can design in such a way that there won't be any picture. It will just be fun. Very, very possible. It will just be fun alone. And the message will be beautiful. Do you understand? Then, okay, we are already moving into design principles. Oh, I see you have been talking about design elements too. Oh my god. Okay, talking about design principles now. You use design principles to achieve design elements. Please, if you don't hear anything that I've been saying since, design principles are very, very important. Because you can see design elements everywhere, but you can't see design principles. Please, if you know you have not been listening before, maybe somebody is distracting you, you have been drinking water, please and please, this is where you have to pay close attention, after attention. And this is why I'm saying that is because when you are talking about color, you can see color. You can see that this is green, this is yellow, this is red, this is, you can see color. If you are talking about lines, you can see lines. Am I right? If you are talking about shape, you can see shape. If you are talking about pattern, you can see pattern. But when it comes to design principles, you can't see them. You experience them. You cannot see. So even if you don't understand line, you don't understand shape, all those things, as time goes by, you can easily grab it. Design principles you are talking about here is contrast. What is contrast? Funny enough, there is contrast everywhere. In fact, in your room, as you are in your room right now, there's contrast in your room. If you don't believe, if you're in your bedroom, check around you. The biggest thing that you probably see, once you enter the, once you enter your house, what's the first thing you see? What's the first thing that comes to your mind? It means that that thing, whatever it is, no matter how big or small, that thing is contrasting with other things in your room. In my own room, the biggest thing that is in my own room is bed. So once you enter, even the TV is smaller than, the TV is smaller than the bed. The fridge is smaller than the bed. The cupboard is smaller than the bed. The bed is the biggest thing. So it means that the bed is contrasting with every other thing in that room. Do you understand? If you look at this design, you can see that this shape here, it has a lot of white space around. This one too has a lot of white black spaces. Of course, we also call it white space, even though it is black. You still call it white space. It has a lot of them around it. Do you understand? So this is contrast. Let me go to google.com and show you how contrast works there. I don't know why, man. If you look at this, look at this too. Look at this space here. This is a shape. Compared to this shape, this one is smaller. This one is bigger. than these two. This is contrast. So when you think about contrast, it's that you can use any, you can use shape. Just like I said, I said that you can use design elements to achieve design principles. So you can use typography to show contrast. You can use shape to show contrast. You can use pattern to show contrast. You can use space. You can use all the design elements to show the design principles. Let me quickly show you an example, a very good example of contrast. I hope you guys can see my screen as I'm drawing something right now. I'm meeting Wayne very soon. See contrast. This is contrast. You can see one is big and one is small. Or I can even, to even make it interesting, I can even make one like this and duplicate this and make this even smaller. You can see contrast. If you are going to see this on the design, this is the first thing you see for, this is the second, this is the third. That is contrast working. I've used shape to show contrast. We use element to show principles. You can see element, but you cannot see principles. Aha. It's just like when anything, any business you are doing in this life, any business, anything you are doing at all, they all have principles. Even life itself has principles. One of the principles of life is the law of gravity. I hope you understand. The law of gravity says that anything that goes up comes down. Can you see the going up and coming down? You can only see the object. The object is that thing that is achieving that principle. You cannot see the principle itself. You can only experience it or you feel it. That is the same thing, exactly the same thing for design principles as well. You can only see the element achieving that principle. I can actually change the color of this thing. I've changed the color, but that principle is still showing. The biggest. And let me show you another funny thing. For you to know how crazy design principles can be. If you don't follow design principles, your design is going to waste. And indirectly, I'm showing you another principle as I'm looking like this now. That's one thing about design. If you are not showing design principles in your design, you are just wasting your time. You must be able to show principles. Principles must reflect. And the funny thing is that you cannot see principles. You can only see the elements. See? I don't know if you know what I'm saying. You cannot see it. Look at this now. I've used design elements of shape to show principles. What principle am I showing? You see contrast. This is still the biggest. And this one is still there. And to an extent, this is also balance. This is a part. This part, let me give you another color, is balancing this part. But the fact that I made this one to be dark a bit now, look at this now. I've used color again to show another design principle, contrast. This one is darker, this one is lighter. If you see this on a page, which one are you going to see most? Which one is calling your attention the most? It's the darker one. So when you look at your design in two, you must always think about the fact that there must be one part of the design that will be calling people's attention the most. Let me show you how this is working, the practicality. Let's go to one of the designs I'm doing. Let me go to Codeless. I do designs for this brand as well. So let me just show you. Look at this. The first thing that comes to your mind, the first thing you probably see is this white, green, yellow, and blue color. These four colors. These are the first thing you probably see first. Why? Because it is contrasting the background. It's contrasting. Do you understand? In fact, look at the way Instagram designed their page. This part has the color, has the image. This part is just white, little text. So this means that this place is contrasting with this place. This place carries more weight than this. That's contrast. Now let me talk too much about contrast. Let's go to another thing. Look at this as well. See contrast. This is the biggest. This one is contrasting the background. and also contrasting with this text here, this small, small text I'm looking at here. Do you understand? You can see how contrast is playing out. This is the biggest, to the smallest, to the smallest, to the tiniest. And even this, you see, another thing about design principles is that they are all related. They are all related. I'll come back to this same example as well to be showing you another design principles working inside there. So that's why I said that if you know you have not paid attention since, this is the time when you pay hard attention, close attention, because you cannot see design principles. You can only feel them. You only see. What's hierarchy about? You can see it already. It looks like contrast, but it's not contrast. It looks like contrast, but it's not contrast. Look at hierarchy playing out here. Look at the small part. Look at all this one big. Look at this one, the biggest. And look at it going smaller, smaller, smaller to the smallest. That is hierarchy. Hierarchy talks about the arrangement of information. It talks about, some people call it information archetype. It talks about what is the smallest thing, what's the biggest, to the biggest, to the one that is the totally big, that is the exact part at the top. Now look at this. Look at, let's look at this layout. Let's come here now. What's the most, the most important thing that you see first? It's probably this episode first, followed by this, followed by this, followed by this, followed by this, followed by this. This designer is very good at hierarchy in this place, because he wants you to, you know, get those information one step at a time. See, eh? I don't know if you get, if anybody or if anyone knows Chiji Ogunye. Chiji Ogunye is a very good designer. He's based in Lagos, in Nigeria. Yeah. Now, there's something he said one time about design. He said that when you are designing a flyer or you are doing any design at all, it's like you are telling somebody a story. It's like you are taking somebody on a journey. You are taking somebody on a journey. Now, if, just imagine if you want to travel and you are going to Ibadan. Would I tell you that? Would I tell Tomisi, Tomisi, you go to Agege, Olade, you go to Ketu, Kore, you go to Oshodi? I will going to scatter you guys like that. No. I'll say, okay, you know what, guys, let us meet at Oshodi. All of us will meet at Oshodi. We'll now take a bus from there to the place we are going. Do you understand? That's the same thing, that same thing applies to design. When you want to design, you have to show the reader that this is what I want to see first. Then this one, then this one, then this one, then this one. Before this will not be the last thing that you reach. Let me show you how that plays out in the flyer that I did for my church. It's a design I did for my church recently. I just did this so you can show you. I hope you guys have seen my screen. If I'm going to ask you, what did you see first when I opened this design? What's the first thing that jumped into your mind? Like, what's the first thing that you saw? Did the image?
Jesus is the answer.
Jesus is there, exactly. That is what I want to see first. And how did I achieve this? Because of this J and this yellow circle. This J and this yellow circle is holding every other thing, it's holding it. So that you not just see the J and you go away. No. I want you to say Jesus is the answer. After that, see the people of, see the media of people that are ministering. Actually, this people, especially this person and this person, they are very big persons to be in the association. If there's somebody here that, if there's anybody here that attends Baptist, you understand what I mean. When you talk about Baptist Association, and you're talking about the moderator. The moderator of Baptist Association is just like you're talking about that Jew. So just imagine if you are being a designer and you see that the duo as the biggest thing in front. The first thing that comes to your mind is Redeemed Church or Christianity. That's the same thing that is applying here. I want to, Jesus is the answer is what I'm preaching to you. And I want to see people that are ministering. So you can see cost, contrast playing out. I can guarantee you that the last thing you probably read on this design is this in collaboration with or the things that are under their name here. Those are the smallest things. And they are not so important. Because if you know their faces, you know their position. But in case you don't know their position, shall the hell. Now check. And May I tell you that there are only three fonts in this design? Only three. This is number one. This is number two, which is my one and only Helvetica. This is number three, this G. Oh, there are four designs. There are four fonts actually. This is number three. Then this ESUS is another font. That's number four. But I only use this font, I only use it here once. This font, I only use it here once. This font here, I only use it once. Every other thing you see on it is Helvetica. So when I say Helvetica is my one and only dog when it comes to design for fonts, I hope you understand. So another thing that you have to also keep in mind is that when you are designing, don't use plenty colors, don't use plenty fonts, don't use plenty shape, don't use anything you are using. It has to be minimal. In Yoruba, you say something like "Iwọntunwọnsi." Anything you are doing, you have to check it. That should be minimal, simple. Don't put too many elements. Do you understand? Don't let us go too much into that. Like, let's do continue. So that is hierarchy. Next, okay, just showing how hierarchy is playing out. I'll probably make this document available to everyone so that you guys can go through it. If this is just showing how hierarchy. So look at this. You're not designing anymore, but you should switch. Look at this. See, this one is like marked. See information as personal arranges. This is the first thing you probably see. Then if you now look deeper, you now see all this other information, all these other things. So you can see that the person used only font to show hierarchy. Font and black, like just one font. So that's why I said that sometimes typography is the most important thing in your design. Look at this as well. Talking about design. Just three colors, black, white, and gray. In fact, you can even classify gray as a shade of black. So you can even see that there are just two colors there. And you can even see that white is the negative space. I say there is only one color here, black. Very possible. Guys, alignment is something I suffered about it, like, so much when I was many. So it should be good, you guys. Pay attention closely. Alignment is actually very simple. We have different types of alignment. We have the vertical, we have the horizontal, we have different alignments like that. We have the left align, we have the right align, we have the top alignment, we have the bottom, we have the center, we have the middle. And you can see this guy is showing us samples here. Sample of good and poor alignment. You can see this is a good alignment, this is poor alignment, and this is a mixed alignment. So having mixed alignment is good, but it's always good for you to just stay with alignment that is okay. This mixed alignment is only used by professionals. People that are so good, they know their craft so much, they can mix anything. Just like when your DJ is mixing DJ mixer, something like that. When they are mixing their machine, they'll be hearing they know what to move at what time. That's the same thing that applies to mixed alignment. So as a starter, I would not advise you to start with mixed alignment. Just stay with good alignment and flow. So as you can see, this one is just showing different alignment here. And this is a sample of mixed alignment. You can see the one that I highlighted. That's a sample of mixed alignment. DJ. Such that if you read this thing, contrast, this is showing here in design, is very effective, is mixed, is hard to read. Do you get? Aha. So these are an example of good alignment. Is just that this thing is the arrangement. This one too is a good alignment. This one too is good, but the text is kind of poor and all. But don't worry, we'll still talk deeply about that. Now, balance. Balance is basically talking about the fact that when you are designing, don't let too much weight be on one side and you have less weight on the other side. Just like what I showed you guys here. If you look at this, just imagine if I did this. This is poor balance. If I'm having my design like this, for instance, or let me just move. Look at it. This is not showing a good. If I want to make it balanced, this one will probably just be like this. You know, probably have something like this to make it balanced. So to an extent, this part balances with this part. But just imagine if we now remove this one. This one is carrying more weight than this. That means that your design is bending towards the side. You are bending the head of your reader towards the side, which is back. Jigger. So very important. You have to think about balance in your design. Like I said, it's a principle. Then proximity. Proximity is how information are close to each other. How are the information very close to each other? How will people easily read them? Uh-huh. And if your proximity is bad, your message will be lost. Repetition. Repetition is a very good, what is it called? A very good aspect of design that is very, very important. Let me please see. I think I used a repetition in one of the designs I used for Codeless. I want to just show you a sample of repetition. Sometimes when you repeat something, people get to see it more than when you don't repeat it at all. So that's why it's good to repeat. I cannot see it. I'll probably just go to template. I know there was a particular design I did for them that I wrote free. Something is actually free. So I need it to be so obvious in the background so that people can read it and see, okay, this thing is actually free. I can't see it here. Let me just go to this page. We'll finish the class very soon. In less than 10 minutes, we should be done. This is not looking good. But then when you repeat an information over and over and over again, people get to see it more. And they get to like understand that information. Do you understand? Let me see the example of repetition here. Oh, it's not here. Simplicity. Simplicity is basically you using minimal elements in your design. Don't use too much elements in your design. That's what simplicity is all about. I hope my network is not breaking. If you guys can hear me, please let me know. Then function. Function.
It's not breaking, sir.
Okay. Function is basically, can people read your design? When they see your design, can they relate? Does it make sense to them? Is the message passed? Is your design functional? That's what function is all about. Okay. Now, that's about the top part of the module. Now, coming here now, let's continue. This one actually doesn't need us to go through any social media page or something. It's something you can just discuss. Now, practical skills you need to be a designer. Not to be a designer. One of the things you need that is very, very important. That is as important as the design you want to do yourself is patience. Please, if your name is not patience, go and add patience to your name. You want to be a designer. And this, why do I say patience? Because the truth is that you are just starting out. You are going to see a lot of criticism. People will say, I don't like this design. You will collect one design almost 20 times. I can remember a time that I used to do one design maybe, just one design in a whole day. I will start in the morning around 8. I'll finish design around 4 or 5. Just one flyer a whole day. So you need patience as a designer. You need patience. A lot of it. You need concentration. You need concentration. A lot of concentration. If you cannot concentrate as a designer, I'm sorry. You may lose it. To be honest. You need a sound mind. You need to pay attention to details. You have to be able to pay attention to details. Your personality is very, very important as a designer. If your personality is bad, oh my God, nobody will give you work. If you are the type that when they tell you, please, we want this design out to be, we want this design to be out by 2 p.m. and 10 p.m., nothing is out. 4 p.m., nothing is out. 6 p.m., nothing is out. Who will give you work next time? Now, one of the things that is very, very key for you as a designer is for you to be able to practice. there's something that says, there's an idea that says that practice makes perfection. If you want to be good at design, you have to be able to practice. And I can recall my growth. I can recall how fast I do when I was practicing and when I was not practicing. There's a huge difference. Now, I'm going to, the books that you're supposed to read as a designer, if you can remember in our embodied session, I told you about the fact that you need to use Scribd. Scribd. Scribd is an app that I use for reading audio books, because one thing is that designers may not be, you may not be chanced to read hardcover books and sometimes soft copy. So you need to like read. As a designer, you have to be able to read though. Ah, if you cannot read, I'm sorry, you're on your own. You cannot do if you cannot read. Not even designing, but in every field. Reading is very, very, very important. So I will tell you the books you should read. I will list them out. But one thing is that when the time comes, I will share a link to Scribd. Everybody, you have to open an account on Scribd, and you have to listen to at least two books. And which I'm going to list the books you are going to listen to. And in one of our class, we are going to review the book. What education or qualification do you need as a designer? You need zero qualification and zero education. The education you need is no more than what we are having currently. You knowing what design includes, no line, no typography, no space, no all these things, no element of design and principles of design. That's the education you need. What's the qualification you need? You need absolutely no education, not institutional qualification. All you need is that, can you do this work? Have you done design for you before? Because somebody wants you to do design for them, they will ask you, let me see the works you have done. Let, show me your portfolio. Your portfolio is your qualification. The things you know in your head is your education as a designer. The benefit of staying inspired and how to stay inspired as a designer. Let me first talk about how to stay inspired. How do you stay inspired as a designer? By looking at other people's work. By asking yourself questions. By traveling. By exploring the world. Going out. You can't get, a lot of designers just sit there in the house. Oh, I pity you. If you're not yet so good and you're sitting in the house, oh, never come. Is that a thing? Except you're great online every time to read, study, see what other people are doing. But for me, especially if you're in Lagos, I would advise you to always go out. When I say go out, I don't say you should go out and party or club. No. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that work out. Just stand up and just move around. See, look at billboards around. Look at flyers everywhere. Look at lampposts on the road. Look at the ways people brand their shops. Sometimes I go to a supermarket, yeah, just to go and see the branding of toothpaste. I see the, for instance, currently I'm working on a tomato paste branding. Now, I've bought about 3 different tomato paste that is, as I'm talking to you, is in my bag. I'm checking them. No, I'm not checking them, I'm talking to you, but I check them once in a while. There was a day I was going to brush my teeth. Then I mistakenly went into the kitchen. Then I saw that a particular woman dropped a nylon of tomato paste on the floor. I picked it. I went to ask her, please, where is the remaining half of this tomato paste? Like, it's a totally new brand. I've not seen it before. And the person said, what is the juice does mean? I went to that dustbin and looked for it. Even though I know eventually see it. But what I'm just trying to say is the fact that, as I said, you have to be inquisitive. When you see things, you mustn't stop there and move on. You have to like ask more questions. Try to know more about whatever it is you are seeing. Now, what's the benefit of staying inspired? One of the greatest benefits of staying inspired is that you are going to know almost everything about every area of design. So you stay inspired by looking at other people's work, reading, doing a lot of going out, discussion, hanging out and all. But one of the major benefits is that, number one, you're going to be able to socialize. You meet new people. You grow your own skill as yourself. You grow your own skill. Do you understand? Funny enough, you can even get more clients by going out. My last job, I got it through a friend that I met in one event. I met the guy in an event. It is just me and that guy that uses CorelDRAW. And I went to meet the guy. I was like, Wale, how are you? This and that. We greeted, we exchanged numbers. What brought us together is the fact that we both use CorelDRAW. And the next job I got was through him. He just called me one day, oh, Peter, are you available for a particular job in Ikeja? Can you take it? I was like, yeah, of course, I can do it. And I went for the interview and I was picked. So just imagine if I didn't go and meet and go with him, I'd be I'd be so disappointed with him at that time. That job probably wouldn't come to you. Do you understand? So there are a lot of benefits to you staying inspired, to you going out, hanging out and meeting other people. So this is going to be the end of the session for today. There's an assignment for you that I'll drop an assignment for you on the group chat. But please, if you have any questions, ask me now. Let's use the next 10 minutes to answer questions. Or 5 minutes, let me see. Questions? I'm waiting. Somebody unmuted.
I have a question, sir.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Yes. You're talking about negative space and white spaces.
Yeah.
And the importance of space in design.
Yes.
I hear people say canty and other stuff. Like, how do we make them understand that we are trying to like make the design bit instead of cluttering everything together? Because I don't think they understand the importance of white spaces.
Okay, I think what you're trying to say is that some people they love busy designs. Designs are very busy. That there's always
yes, sir.
Now, people like that, so for me, personally for me, when I want to work with people and they are telling me to do busy design, I tell them I don't do busy design. I'm a minimalist. I work based on minimalism. And I will tell the person that at least the works, most of my works you see that they are minimalist. They are spaces around. Sometimes I educate some clients and some of them they used to hear, some they don't hear. I've had about 2 clients. Left me because I was trying to explain to them why their design is minimal, and they're saying no, that they want busy design. I said, I'm sorry, I cannot produce busy design. Of course, they paid me off from, and I've done like 2 or 3 revisions. You cannot collect your money again. Yeah, the money you paid is for the work I've done. So if you want to go elsewhere, fine. But you cannot ask me for the fund, which of course they didn't even mention. But one thing is that they saw my portfolio, they saw the work I've done in the past, they saw that they are all minimal. Even if I take you to my page, most of my designs are very minimal, very, very minimal. In fact, I just use image to just communicate the message and you get it all. Look at this. So, I don't see the message that you made it. But I hope you guys can see what I'm saying. You can see spaces all around. It's very, very important. So if a client is telling you, use all the space is too small, this and that, just tell them that you do minimal designs and your design needs to breathe. Like if you cannot breathe, if the spaces are too much, you will not be able to read it. But then, no matter how you explain to some clients, they will never listen. So clients like that are not meant for you. Let's be honest with ourselves. Except you want to stress yourself on, let's say, a job of 10,000 and you talk of like 20,000 it's already wasted. So except you want to do that. But it's not every client that left. So explain to them, this is why you are doing this. You are a professional. This is why you are doing this. But they are saying that, no, do that busy thing. If you can do it, go ahead. If you cannot do it, tell them you are sorry you cannot do it. Any other question? Did I answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
If you like it, click like. Try to comment and subscribe.